A very warm welcome, dear children, to the class of biology. In the previous class, we talked about the characteristics of living organisms. And as all of you know, that we are doing the first chapter of biology, that is the living world, right? And in the last class, we discussed about the characteristics of the living organisms. That is, we talked about how living organisms are different from the non-living organisms. And in that, we'll just do a quick recap. We talked about growth as one characteristic. We talked about reproduction as one characteristic. Then we talked about metabolism. We talked about cellular organization. And then we talked about consciousness, right? And then we discussed that growth and reproduction cannot be taken as the basic characteristics of living organisms, right? Then we talked about the different types of reproduction, sexual and asexual reproduction. In asexual reproduction, we talked about binary fission, multiple fission, budding, fragmentation, regeneration. And then, of course, we talked about in metabolism, we differentiated anabolic and catabolic reactions. And then, of course, I had given you a few questions as assignment, and I want those questions on WhatsApp. Right, so I'll start checking those questions, and there are not many questions, and I'm sure you can do it quickly. And those who've already done, you can just take a picture of that and post it on the WhatsApp group that we've made. Alright, so we come to the next part of this lesson. Right, when we talk about our planet Earth, right? When we move outside a house, we come across different types of living organisms, right? When you move out, you will see, of course, the human beings. You will see different kinds of animals, right? You'll see dogs, cats, rats, etc., right? In school, you can see many squirrels. Then you see so many birds around, right? Apart from that, you also come across different types of plants, right? Variety of plants you can see, right? They're different. You can see Ashoka tree, you can see bougainvillea, you can see other flowering plants, etc., right? And those of you who have a vegetable garden at home can see a variety of vegetable plants, right? So what we get to see is we see a variety of living organisms, right? So related to this, the variety of living organisms, the topic that we will start today is we will talk about diversity in the living organism, right? Now, diversity means variety. Variety of what? Variety of living organisms. And so today, we will discuss about biodiversity. We will talk about biodiversity, right? Again, let's quickly break up the word to understand the meaning. We've already talked about the word biology. We had broken that up and we said that it is made up of two Greek terms, bios and logos, and we said that bios means life. So here, bio means life and diversity means variety, right? So what do we get to see? What do we get to know over here? Variety of living organisms, right? So then what do we understand by the term biodiversity is that we talk about a variety of living organisms in a particular geographical area, right? So the number of types of species in a particular geographical area is biodiversity, right? Now, when you read your NCERT books, you will come across mentioned over there in the book that there are around 1.7 to 1.8 million living organisms. 1.7 to 1.8 million living organisms, right? So when we talk about the living organisms means we are talking about the animals, we are talking about the plants, and the most talked about organism in this lockdown period is a connecting link between the living and the non-living world. What is that connecting link called? It's a virus, right? So these days we're talking about the coronavirus, right? The deadly virus which is killing so many living beings, right? So many humans, right? So of course, then we talk about, when we talk about biodiversity, we are discussing the animals, we're discussing about the plants, and of course those organisms which are not visible to our naked eyes, right? So even they are included in that. So 1.7 to 1.8 million organisms, right? So this is equivalent to 17 lakh to 18 lakh living organisms, right? So related to this, in the medicals also a question is asked, right, about the number of living organisms that have been discovered as yet, right? So remember one thing, these are the number of organisms discovered, they've been studied, but still there are so many organisms which have yet not been discovered and of course then yet not studied, right? So 1.7 to 1.8 million organisms, living organisms, have been discovered so far, right? Now again, when we talk about biodiversity, and then we said biodiversity is actually the number of living organisms found in a particular geographical area. So let's try to understand this a little more. Now when you go to the zoo, you do you get to see only one type of animal over there? No, when you go to the zoo, you see a variety of animals, right? You can see lions over there, you can see deer, you can see giraffe, you can see snakes, right? You can see different types of birds, right? Like this, you can see so many different types of animals. So when we go to a zoo, we get to see a variety of living organisms, right? So let's try to understand it a little more, that what is the meaning of biodiversity. I am drawing two areas over here, right? Let's say two geographical areas over here. I am naming one as A and I am naming the other as B, right? Now I am putting the number of living organisms in each geographical area, right? So let's see, I'll denote it as I'm sure this must be reminding you of some game that you play. I know the game. See the other one. So right. So this is how I've shown two geographical areas. And now we will talk about the living organisms present over here in these two areas. Now, if we talk about the number of living organisms, right? Now, just try to understand. The number of living organisms, then we get to see that in a geographical area, the number of living organisms is more as compared to B. The number of living organisms is less, right? But now if we talk about the different types or varieties of living organism, we get to see in A there are only two types of living organisms, right? So one is denoted by a zero and the other is denoted by a cross. So there are two species, let's say, of living organisms. Whereas if we talk about the geographical area B, we get to see over here that there are three types of living organisms, right? One is denoted by X, one is denoted by zero, and the other is a black square, right? So three types. Then in this case, out of the two areas, which one is more richer in biodiversity, right? Means richer in biodiversity means which of the two areas have more different types of living organisms. So here, of course, B has 3 species, whereas A has only 2 species. So the biodiversity is more in the geographical area B as compared to the geographical area A, right? So when we talk about biodiversity, remember we do not talk about the total number of living organisms, right? We talk about the different species of living organisms, a variety of living organisms. That means when we were talking about 1.7 to 1.8 million living organisms, we were referring to 1.7 to 1.8 million species that have been studied, right? That is not the total population of the living organisms that we were talking about, but we talked about the number of species that have been discovered so far and that have been studied so far, right? So that is about biodiversity. That means we, in biodiversity, we talk about the number of living organisms, number of species, a variety of living organisms found in a geographical area. Now, since we know what is biodiversity, and we also know that there are so many different types of species found, right? Just now we studied 1.7 to 1.8 million organisms, right? So many species found on Earth. Then how do we study these living organisms? How do we study about so many different types of living organisms? Imagine 1.7 to 1.8 million organisms. How do we study? So what do we have to do to keep in mind the characteristics, the names, etc. of these living organisms, right? So now, to know more about these living organisms, now we already know what is biodiversity, and we also know that there are so many types of living organisms. Now we need to know more about them, right? What are these living organisms? What characteristics do they possess, right? And how are they differentiated from each other? So the first step to know about these living organisms is, they need to be identified first, right? So identification is the first thing that that we need to know. And after identification comes the naming of the living organisms, right? So the first thing is that we need to know what are the characteristics of these organisms so that they can be identified. Once that identification is done, the next step comes nomenclature, right? A big word, nomenclature. Nomenclature. The next term that you will come across would be nomenclature. Looks like a big, huge word, right? And you must be wondering that now what are we going to study? Such big terms we are going to study in biology, it would be very difficult. No, but this is not difficult. You know, what is nomenclature? Is something very, very simple. As simple as naming an organism, right? It is as simple as naming an organism. When you children were born, when I was born, in every religion, you know, there's a ceremony where the name of the child is kept, right? So nomenclature is also something like that. That is, simply naming a living organism is known as nomenclature. Although a big word, but very, very simple, right? Now suppose a scientist has discovered a new organism, right? And he has studied the features of that new organism and now wants to give a name to that living organism, right? Now, a name by which the organism will be recognized, by a name by which it would be known, right? Which should be commonly known, we can say, right? Now suppose the scientist gives it one particular name, right? See, what happens is, whenever we talk about nomenclature or naming of an organism, a scientist has to select such a name that by which that organism would be known worldwide by the same name, right? It should not be like in India, it is known by a name, let's say A in India, right? In USA, it is known by B, right? And then let's say in UK, it is known by C, right? So in different countries, if they are known by different names, then how will people living in India, if they are talking about A, then how would people living in UK know which organism is A? Maybe for them, organism A is something else, right? So, you know, like there is, nobody will be able to communicate and know about these organisms so well. That means such a name should be taken. The scientist has to keep a name that is, you know, worldwide, it is accepted, right? So this is a very, very important thing when we talk about nomenclature or naming of an organism, right? So the worldwide, it has to be accepted. So what is simply nomenclature? It is the process of naming an organism in such a way that it is known by the same name all over the world, right? So what is it? It is simply a process of naming an organism in such a way that it is known by the same name all over the world. So that is simply nomenclature. And this nomenclature was put forward by a scientist known as Carlos Linnaeus. Right? So he was the scientist who had put forward nomenclature, that means to name a living organism. It is actually to give a scientific name to a living organism, right? So again here, when we talk about the scientific name of a living organism, there are always two components of the name, the scientific name, right? So we can say that the scientific name has two components. So let's see here. The scientific name has two components, right? And the first component, and then whenever we say that a scientific name has two components, then this nomenclature is known as binomial nomenclature, right? Then it is known as binomial nomenclature, right? From this word bi means two, right? So a scientific name always has two components, right? So the first component is the genus in the scientific name, and the second component is the specific epithet, right? Or also known as species, right? So binomial nomenclature having two names. So a scientific name always has two components. That is why it is binomial nomenclature. Two components that are present in a scientific name. The first component, that means the first name, represents the genus, and the second name represents the specific epithet or the species, right? So up till now, what we've talked about? We've talked about biodiversity, that is the number of living organisms in a particular area. Then we talked about, since there are so many variety of living organisms, so we need to name them. So we talked about nomenclature. We said that this word nomenclature was put forward by Carlos Linnaeus, and then he gave another term to the nomenclature, that was binomial nomenclature. This binomial nomenclature is having two components to a scientific name. The first component is the genus, and the second component is the specific epithet or species, right? So Carlos Linnaeus was also known as the father of nomenclature or the father of taxonomy, right? So Carlos Linnaeus, again, was known as father or nomenclature and was also known as the father of taxonomy. We'll come across this word just now, we'll study. Right, why father of nomenclature? Because it was Carlos Linnaeus only who had put forward the nomenclature as well as the binomial nomenclature. That is why he discovered this, that is why he is known as the father of nomenclature. Then again, let us take an example of a scientific name, since we know that in binomial nomenclature, a scientific name has two components. So let us take up an example of binomial nomenclature, right? So we'll take up an example of the fruit mango, right? The fruit mango, again the scientific name of the fruit mango is Mangifera indica, right? So Mangifera indica is the scientific name. I'll just write it here, Mangifera indica, right? So this is the scientific name of the fruit mango. Then when we talk about human beings, so it is Homo sapiens . Right, Homo sapiens is the scientific name of human being. Then again, you come across so many names: Panthera leo, this is the scientific name of lion, right? So there are many other more names, many scientific names. Now what do you get to see over here? That you get to see that each scientific name of a living organism, whether it's an animal or a plant, has two components to it, right? The first component is the genus and the second component is the species. Similarly, in the second one, the first component you can see is the genus, the second component is the species or the specific epithet, right? So this is what is binomial nomenclature. Right, so we know that scientific names are found having two components. The first component is the genus and the second component is the specific epithet or the species. Right, so that's about binomial nomenclature. So then, do these organisms have any other name other than the scientific name? Yes, of course. All the organisms have a scientific name and they have another name to that, which we say is a common name, right? So like I told you, I write the scientific name of mango, that is Mangifera indica, right? So that is the scientific name of mango, right? And mango is the common name, right? Like for example, if let me take an example of my own self, right? So I am known at my workplace as Nina Das, right? But at my home, I may be known by some other name, right? So the name by which my family members know me is my common name, right? And Nina Das is my official name, right? I will not say a scientific name, but this is just to differentiate, right? Nina Das is my official name, which I use at my workplace. I use when I was studying in school, then whatever forms I fill, right? All my bank accounts, etc. will be in this official name only, right? So likewise, all the living organisms, they have a common name. That common name that I am talking about, stating my own example, we say that that is the nickname or the pet name. I am sure all of you must be having some nickname or some pet name by which your parents, your grandparents call you at home. Right, so that's your common name. In the same way, every living organism has a common name and it also has a scientific name. Right, so again here, in the same way, Mangifera indica is the scientific name of mango. Right, now, so to avoid any kind of confusion, the organisms were given scientific name. Right, so what is the importance of the scientific name. That means the scientific name is approved worldwide, right? Everybody all over the world would understand if we use the scientific name Mangifera indica. Everybody would know that we're talking about mango, right? So to avoid this confusion, like if it is called by different names in different places, nobody could understand what are we talking about, right? So to avoid this confusion, scientific name was ruled. It was made a rule that every living organism would have a scientific name. Now suppose, for example, if a scientist has discovered a new organism, right? He has discovered a new organism, he has studied all the features, he know about the characteristics of the living organism, and now he has to give a name to that living organism. And he thinks about giving the name Mangifera indica, right, to a new organism. Now, would he be able to give that name to that organism, the new organism? No. Why no? Because Mangifera indica is the name of an organism which has, living organism, which has earlier been discovered, right? And already a name has been given to, this particular name has been given to that organism. Now, the same name cannot be used for naming a new organism, right? So, of course, it is very, very difficult, right? Because there's so many species all over the world. How would one person know the names or the scientific names of all the species? Maybe I know the name of a few species, you know the name of few other species. Maybe the one that I know, you don't know, and the one that you know, I don't know, right? So then, to solve this problem, there is an organization, and this organization, the two organizations, in fact, and these two organizations are ICBN and ICZN, right? The two organizations are ICBN and ICZN. ICBN and ICZN. Right, now ICBN and ICZN, what do they do? They have a full data of nomenclature of plants as well as animals, right? So what does ICBN stand for? Stands for International Code of Botanical Nomenclature. Right? International Code of Botanical Nomenclature. So, yeah, of Botanical Nomenclature. So then ICZN is the International Code of Zoological Nomenclature. Right, so in the first class we talked about the two streams of biology, in which we discussed that there are two streams. One is botany, where we study the plants, about the plants, and the other stream is zoology, where we study about the animals. Right, so again here, International Code of Botanical Nomenclature is related to botany, so plants, right, so the nomenclature of the different varieties of plants are there, and then the International Code for Zoological Nomenclature means for the animals, right? So this two organizations, they consist the full data of the names of all the living organisms, plants in one and animals in the other. So this is how the scientist also gets to know if a name has already been given, right? So these organizations, we see that they, with help of this data, you know, we get to know about the nomenclature of different plants and animals, right? So a quick recap we will do of nomenclature, right? So we talked about nomenclature, and we know that nomenclature was put forward by Carlos Linnaeus, and then we came across another term, that is the binomial nomenclature, that was also put forward by Carlos Linnaeus. And in binomial nomenclature, we discussed about naming of living organisms, giving them a scientific name, and there are two components of the scientific name. The first component is the genus and the second component is the species, right? And we saw a few examples, and then we know that ICBN and ICZN are the organizations which have a data of the nomenclature of plants and animals, right? Now we know, knowing that the scientific names are given, and then there's a genus, and then there's a species that has to be, you know, written as the scientific name. This is not only, it does not end over here, right? Anyways, we just cannot give a scientific name, right? So there are certain rules that have to be followed for writing the scientific name, right? So again here, these rules for writing the scientific name was also put forward by Carlos Linnaeus only, right? So we are just talking about Carlos Linnaeus right now, right? So by now you should have, you know, mugged up the name of the scientist, Carlos Linnaeus. And how many variety of living organisms have been discovered so far? I told you in the beginning, it is 1.7 to 1.8 million living organisms, right? So million varieties or species of living organisms that we talked about. So now we come to the rules of binomial nomenclature. That means what are the rules that have to be followed while writing the scientific name. And then we said that these rules were also put forward by Carlos Linnaeus, right? So, and we said that of course it cannot be written in any way we feel like, right? So that is why there are a set of rules. So the first rule is that all the scientific names are Latin and they are written in italics, right? So all the scientific names are Latin, right, derived from this language, and they are written in italics, right? So that is the first name, that all the scientific names are Latin and they are written in italics, right? And of course the second rule, you all know that every scientific name has two components, right? The first component is the genus and the second component is the species or the specific epithet, right? Now the third rule is that the first alphabet of the genus starts with a capital letter, right? So the first alphabet of genus starts with a capital letter, whereas the first alphabet of species starts with a small letter, right? I hope you remembered the examples that I wrote on the board. I gave three examples, scientific names. One was Mangifera indica, then I wrote Homo sapiens and Panthera leo. And if you remember, I have written both the names separately, and the name of the genus I started with a capital letter, whereas the name of the species I started with a small letter. Now the fourth rule is, whenever handwritten, like how I was writing on the board, and like how you people also will be writing in your notebooks, both the names have to be underlined separately. Both names have to be underlined separately, right? So these are the four main rules. And then of course there's another rule, that if the scientist who has discovered, if that scientist's name has to be added, then after the two components, that is after the species, first component is the genus, second component is the species. So after species, the name of the scientist can be added, right? So the example that I wrote was Mangifera indica, right? So let's see here, the two components, the first one is the genus, the second one is the species. The genus starts with a capital letter, whereas the species starts with a small letter. And whenever handwritten, both have to be underlined separately, right? Now, if the name of the scientist who has discovered is added, then suppose Carlos Linnaeus, so we write it here, right? But now what we will be doing is, whenever we talk about the scientific names and we write it in our notebook, we will just write the scientific names only, right? So that's about the rules of the scientific name. So we have quick recap of the rules. Just read on the blackboard while I'm speaking. The first is that all the scientific names are Latin and they are written in italics, right? The second is that there are two components of the scientific name. The first one is the genus and the second one is the species. The third one is the first alphabet of the genus. It is written with a capital letter. And the second alphabet of the species, the first alphabet of the species is written with a small letter. And the fourth one is, whenever handwritten, both names have to be underlined separately. And if the name of the scientist is added, then after the name of the species, the name of the scientist is added, and that too a short form, in which is added in a very short way. Like I see for Carlos Linnaeus, I've written just L-I-N-N, that is Lin, right? So that is about the scientist, right? So these were the rules. Now comes the next part. So many species, right? Study becomes difficult, right? So they have been identified, they have been named, and now comes the next part, that is classification, right? Again, a very, very important part, classification. Right, so whenever we go to a departmental store to buy the grocery, right, and all the items that are required at home, suppose we want to buy a bathing soap for us, right, and suppose we want to buy, let's say, toothpaste, right, and let's say cooking oil, right, so when we go to the departmental store, there are different sections for each type. Now you see that there's a separate section where only bathing soaps are kept, right? And that too, when we talk about the bathing soaps, all the different brands are also arranged separately. It is not that all the brands are mixed and kept, right? Then if you move on to the toothpaste section, you want to buy toothpaste, there's another section of toothpaste. You see different varieties of toothpaste all stacked together, right? So what do we get to see over here in these departmental stores is that all the similar items, right, articles having similar characteristics are grouped together and they are kept in one section, right? So that is what is simply classification, right? What is classification? It is simply grouping of living organisms based on their characteristics, right? Organisms or you can say species or living organism having similar characteristics are grouped together in one category, right? Whereas, based on the similarities and differences only, these organisms are based into different categories. So that is about classification, right? So again, here it becomes, very easy for us to understand and know about the characteristics of living organisms once these living organisms are classified into different categories or they are classified into different groups. So what is classification? we know that the organisms, based on their similarities, you know, they're classified into a separate particular group, right? And all the observable characteristics of the organisms are taken into consideration over here, right? So simply grouping of organisms into different categories on the basis of the observable characters. So what is it? Grouping of the living organisms into different categories based on their observable characters. Right? So this is what is classification. And then when we talk about classification, we will study three different types of classification. One is the natural classification, then we study about the artificial classification and the phylogenetic classification. But we won't go into the detail of these classifications in this particular lesson, because in other lessons we will study about these classifications in detail. But we will just have an overview, a brief overview of what these types of classifications are. Right? So, we talked about three types of classification. Let me write it here only. The first one is natural classification. Second is artificial. And the third is phylogenetic classification. Right. Now, what is natural classification? It is when the external and the internal characteristics equally both are taken into consideration, and according to these characteristics the organisms are classified into a particular group. This type of classification is known as natural classification. So what is it? It is actually where the external as well as the internal characteristics are taken into consideration. So that is natural classification, and on the basis of these external and internal characteristics the organisms are classified, right? Second type of classification we see is artificial classification, right? Now in artificial classification what happens? Only the external features are taken into consideration. That means the organisms are classified based on their external features or observable, external observable characteristics. Right? Aristotle as well as Carlos Linnaeus both have used the artificial classification when they have classified the living organisms. Right? And Aristotle is also known as the father of zoology, or the father of biology also, right? So Aristotle and Carlos Linnaeus, all throughout we'll be talking about Carlos Linnaeus, right? So he has classified the organisms on the basis of artificial classification, right? And then we come across the last type of classification, which is the phylogenetic classification. And phylogenetic classification, it is related to the evolution, right? It is based on evolution. So phylogenetic basically means evolutionary, right? This basically means evolutionary, right? So classification that is based on evolution, right? Or we can say evolutionary relationship. So that classification which is based on evolutionary relationship is known as phylogenetic classification, right? And this phylogenetic classification also shows genetic relationship also between the different organisms. And John Hutchinson is the scientist who had put forward this phylogenetic classification. And John Hutchinson, he developed and proposed this system based on Bentham and Hooker. These were also the scientists. So based on Bentham and Hooker, John Hutchinson, he has put forward the phylogenetic classification. So that's about these three types of classification, and we will do these classifications more in detail in the other chapters, right? So today what we did was we talked about biodiversity, we discussed about nomenclature, we discussed about binomial nomenclature, and we said that Carlos Linnaeus had put forward these two terms, right? Nomenclature, binomial nomenclature. Then we talked about what is binomial nomenclature, simply naming of the organism and the scientific name having two components, that is the genus and the species, right? Then we talked about the rules of the classification, and when we discussed the rules, we basically talked about the four rules. The first rule being that the name should be Latin and in italics, right? That should have two components, the genus and the species. The third one was the name of the genus, the first alphabet of the genus should start with a capital letter, and the first alphabet of the species should start with a small letter. And then the fourth one, when handwritten, it should be underlined separately, right? And then we discussed what is classification, also put forward by Carlos Linnaeus. We talked about three types of classification: natural, artificial, and phylogenetic, right? So you'll find an attachment of assignment. You please finish your previous assignment, and in the next class I want both the assignments together. If you've still not finished your completed a previous assignment, please finish it off, and by the next class on WhatsApp I want the assignment for today's lesson as well, right? So go through the lesson, read the PDF that you've got, and you know, just keep revising. Don't leave it pending for the last minute, that when the exam will come then you will study, right? So start to keep reading your work. So that's about it for today. Have a nice day. Thank you.